because I love the concept that networking is like pedagogy. We learn from the process. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, David. Who's next?
Hi, this is Forrest, and I'm here primarily on telephone because I need to travel. Let's see, I'm in Santa Barbara, California, and let's see, exciting in climate change. Actually working with a number of people in agriculture and building soil as it can help pull the carbon out of the atmosphere.
Ah, that's wonderful. Thank you so much, Forrest. Who's checking in next?
I'm Karen Snyder, and I'm calling in from Chicago. And I've been involved with the work of the Institute of Cultural Affairs in Accelerate 77 program, trying to accelerate sustainability in all 77 of Chicago's neighborhoods.
Awesome. Thank you for your work. Thank you, Karen. Who's next?
I'll go next. This is Grady McGonigal in Brookline, Massachusetts. I'm attracted to this conversation and to this in particular because of to learn more about Beth Tener's work and Jen, although I know less about hers, in networking, which I see as relevant to what a group of us here in Brookline who've established a chapter of Elders Climate Action is interested in exploring as a potential model for how we expand. And I'm inspired by the commitment of Rick, who's on this call, and others with whom I'm working on in that effort. Where I see people, a number of people stepping up and really putting in time and creativity to make something happen.
Thank you, Grady.
So I'm Rick. You've already, in a sense, heard my check-in a few minutes ago because I'm sort of actively puzzling out how to create this session that would engage people whose point of views on the climate I don't know. And I'm looking forward, too, to seeing some of you at NCDD in October. If any of you need a place to stay, I am not far from the conference headquarters, so it's a possibility anyways.
Thank you for your generous offer, Rick. Who's next?
Yeah, Mike Huggins. I'm in Eau Claire, Wisconsin. And the group I've been working with for the last 6 months is started out as an ad hoc group looking at ecological spirituality. And we've just completed some pilot discussions, interfaith discussions, and we're looking, and our group has grown substantially. So very excited about how that expands to other congregations and faiths in the community.
Great. Thank you so much. The presenters can introduce themselves too, if you would, and just check in.
Sure, I'll go. It's Beth Tener. I'm based in New Market, New Hampshire, which is about an hour north of Boston. And I have been working a lot in Massachusetts with the climate action work there. And a lot of hard work helped defeat a big pipeline that seemed like a rather done deal. So that was exciting this spring.
I'm Jennifer Berman. I live in Holyoke, Massachusetts, in Western Mass. And I there's just lots of great work, I feel like, happening around the country around climate. So lots of folks trying to work in new networked ways, looking at more systems approaches. And I just think lots of really creative, interesting work happening in different places. So I'm excited.
Thanks so much, Jen.
I can go. This is Linda Eleanor again. I'm in Tucson, Arizona. I just got back actually from something called the People's Summit in Chicago, where I was able to visit with Ted Wysocki for an afternoon. And so I was really interested to learn what the Bernie Sanders crew is kind of doing around climate change. And it was very exciting. They're really calling it the movement moment and are going to hopefully keep everything going politically, even though Bernie didn't win the nomination. So it'll be interesting to see how that unfolds. And I've got two big things I'm doing here that are exciting, something called Advance 2030, which is a effort to help large building owners in a demarked place within cities to lower their carbon footprint by 2030. We're just getting that off the ground. And I may take advantage of something that maybe that ICA is doing. Nice to see you, Jen, in terms of what ICA is doing in October to get some pro bono facilitation going for this particular group. So I'm excited about that. And I just did my first train-the-trainer on building resilient neighborhoods here in Tucson. So, and we needed it because we're having a big heat emergency here. It's 120 degrees. So talk about climate change.
Thank you. We have a couple people who have not checked in. I just want to offer the opportunity. Jan, Sophia, a few others.
I haven't checked in either. Susan Davis, I'm happy to be with you. Thank you.
Welcome, Susan. Do you want to share a little bit more about where you're calling from and something that you're...
Sure. I'm in Ecuador, but I spent most of my life in the States creating a collaboration innovation method that's been used successfully for social venture capital, corporate social responsibility, solar, organics, economic empowerment of women, microenterprise, and consciousness. So I gifted that 3 years ago to Greed America after proving a model that works for just about any group that has a certain level of consciousness. So we're spreading it as widely as possible. There are 12 innovation networks in formation right now on things like no GMOs, et cetera. And it's ideal for climate change because all of our work is climate change based. So I wanted to let your group know that the information is all offered free at kinsinnovation.org, K-I-N-S. And then for people who are trying to do kind of corporate climate, a corporate culture kind of KINS networks like No GMOs, that's being done out of Green America, the Center for Sustainability Solutions. So we're trying to spread the method widely because it was developed in one network after another, 40 networks in 40 years. And so it's a very, very successful and just time efficient, cost efficient, a lot of fun. So that's what I thought I would just spread it to your group because it sounds like you could use it a lot.
Thank you, Susan. I really appreciate your sharing your resource with it. This is not exactly a group. This is actually a network where each time we have at least half of the people who join are here for the first time just to connect with each other and hear who else is out there and get support and inspiration. And it would be great if you want to post something about your KINS innovation on our Kiko chat. We're building a bit of a library of resources, so please feel free to send anything you'd like in. So,
well, I'm 74, and I'm not very good at internet things, so if there's anyone in your group that would like to make the resources available to your group, I can certainly work with them so they can do that, but I can't do that. I'm kind of retired.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for letting us know, and we'll make sure that we get information about it up there. Who'd like to check in next?
I will. This is Ted Wysocki. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Good afternoon. This is my second D&D meeting, and I appreciate the opportunity to interact with you. And the Institute of Cultural Affairs, headquartered here in Chicago, is currently exploring with our technology of participation facilitators in 10 cities of doing forums in October on climate action in conjunction with both environmental groups in those cities as well as community development groups. And I'm a member of the guide team for the top climate action team that is doing our next virtual meeting a week from tomorrow, where we'll be finalizing an outreach memo and hearing what some of our colleagues have been doing in the Twin Cities and in Denver. Some of you know Marty Roach, who's part of this group, and she's actually at the Citizens Climate Lobby activities as we in D.C. and she'll be giving a report next week on the interactions there. And so I would hope that after next week, we'll be able to share with you sort of an outreach memo that we're doing about our plans. And we had an opportunity to talk to Linda when she was here about some of the possibilities in Tucson. And I think Karen Snyder, I saw her face on our call, is also working with me about outreach and particularly to many of our colleagues in the Denver area. So I'm complete, as we like to say.
Thank you so much, Ted. That's very exciting. 10 forums in October in 10 different places. That's, sounds like great work, and thank you for sharing it with us. Who's next?
I was trying to get online so I would see everybody on a large screen, but I'm still getting my Zoom to work. I'm sure it'll pop out eventually. But I'm Sophia, and I'm coming in, as Rosa mentioned, to get to know this network first time. This was an invitation by Sharon Joy in Tampa Bay, Florida, a dear friend and inspiration. I've been involved in this training of methodology related to managing complex issues. It's called wind tunneling. It's a software, but at the same time, it is a human process. So there's got a lot of the social components to it, as dealing with complexity is never up to only a software, right? So I wanted to learn more about what's happening out there, and specifically on this topic of climate change, and see how what I know can be a support to what you all know. So then there's this rich picture or this multiplicity of perspectives that can create best scenarios for action. And that's my check-in. Oh, I'm originally from Brazil. I am living in Washington, D.C. area, but I'm currently in Los Angeles. Been pretty nomadic for a while, so not yet rooted myself in a neighborhood or a community, so to speak. But I got married last year, so there is a search for home and grounding now. My husband and I, we're also very interested in, my husband and I very much interested in consciousness and spirituality and human development, indigenous knowledge, cosmology, everything that brings human consciousness and humankind forward and closer to our planet home.
Welcome, Sophia. We can see you now. I don't know
if you can see. Yes. Oh, there you go.
Yes.
So I'm going to log off of the phone.
Okay, great. Welcome. And this is, you know, the intention of why we started this is so that we can learn new techniques, new tools, new methodologies, new approaches. And I'm very interested to learn more about wind tunneling as we move forward. Okay, who hasn't checked in yet?
I'll go if you can hear me. My name is Bruce Nayewith. I live in Great Barrington, very close to Rosa. I do a lot of things. I'm a member of Physicians for Social Responsibility locally, 350 Mass, I guess you would say something we're doing. There's a group that collaborates with local legislators. We give him briefings and he tells us where he thinks the strategy is for climate action based on what he knows about the Massachusetts State House. So that's kind of nice. I'm also helping design an event that brings intuitives and activists together to try to get nonlinear access to information that relates to what wants to come forth in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Bruce. All right. I should probably check in as well. My name is Rosa Suizetleta. I live in Great Barrington. Bruce and I are actually married. And I have just completed doing some work with some local people where we did a Living the Change festival here in the Berkshires, and the intention was to celebrate all of those wonderful accomplishments that have been made by activists, and through the opportunity to celebrate not just the activists, but also the sustainability folks. We have a lot of sustainability efforts in our local area, a lot of local food, all kinds of wonderful things like that. Just reach out and expand and bring more people into the work that we're doing. And there's a wonderful core of people that we are working with who are wanting to continue going forth. And so it feels neat to have a small group that's doing something here locally, even while a lot of what I do is internet-based and online. So that's it for me right now. Check. Anyone else who hasn't checked in? Jan, did we hear from you?
She's on the Kiko chat.
Oh, okay. Let's see. Jan said that she will check in via chat as she's not connected to audio video. She's been working on many levels of climate engagement and action, and today she's wanting a refresher on networking, which is a perfect segue. So unless we have anyone else, I'm happy to turn it over to you, Beth.
Okay, so thank you. Good to be here, and thank you all for coming. So I'll give you a quick bit of my background, and then the plan is tonight, I think a lot of the ways to understand networks, and I think of it really as a network mindset, is through storytelling and kind of seeing, much like sustainability, you know, you sort of get this way of seeing the world. It's a lens and a mindset, and it starts to then inform what you go do in very different ways. So I'm going to give some principles and some theory as we go, but tell a lot of different stories of how groups related to energy efficiency, renewables, climate change are using network principles in some really exciting ways, as well as systems thinking is a big part of this. And I roped in my friend Jennifer Berman, who's really she's been one of my heroes in terms of how she took these ideas and just made it happen in Vermont with a really great model of an energy action network. Jen's also very familiar with the REAMP model and is doing a lot of work now with philanthropy and networks and thinking about the roles funders play in adopting this kind of way of funding the work and thinking about how to organize the work. So with that, I'm gonna try sharing so just a quick thing about my background. So I've been in the role of being a consultant facilitator for 20 some years. I started out my career at Arthur D. Little doing corporate environmental social responsibility consulting in big corporations on environmental compliance. Got the bug for sustainability in the late 90s, and as well as kind of like simple living. So quit my corporate role and co-founded a small nonprofit called Sustainable Step New England well before there was a market or anyone paying for that kind of work. It seems to be my life path. And in that work, we did a lot of training on what is sustainability, how do you integrate sustainability, ecological principles, the way we design businesses and products and towns and run organizations. And towards the end of my work, about the 7 or 8 years I was working with that, I really started to see why network ways of organizing, networking across organizations, cross-sector networks were going to be critical to achieving the kind of sustainability goals as well as climate action goals necessary. And it really, to me, the network thinking is very much based in the principles of ecology and how does nature evolve and adapt and how do ecosystems work. And so it really is kind of the evolution of thinking about sustainability into how we organize and do the work is very much informed by system thinking principles. So with that, I'm going to share my screen and maybe you can just confirm that you can all see this, these slides. Can you see those?
Yes, I can.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
I am by phone. This is David in Tampa. I'm by phone. I cannot see it, but I can listen well.
Okay, I'll try and describe.
Some specifics.
Thanks. Yeah. So today we're going to talk about networks as sort of a new path and a new way to think about enabling collaborative work on climate change. And so if you think about most of the way we kind of do get work done is in organizations. It's sort of what we inherited. We just think that's the way it has to be done. And those often have a lot of assumptions based in hierarchy and command and control, and you know, actually inherited from kings and things like that. So in those models, we all know what can tend to happen as each organization develops their strategy, and we end up with a lot of fragmentation and disconnect across silos. And in the social change world, if you know, I do a lot of work now as a consultant with New Directions with foundations and nonprofits, and you know, each organization starts from where they are. Here's us, and here's the world out there, and we need a strategy. We need a theory of change. Everyone develops their own kind of SWOT analysis and their own view of the world, which makes total sense to get grants and get funding, or in government or business, that's what you do. You develop strategies and you implement them. The problem is, each organization is a participant in a larger ecosystem where no one's really seeing what the other ones are doing. And so you often will have all these people working on the same issue in the same region, you know, not connecting what they're doing. And so a network lens is really starting to say, how do we create conditions for the ecosystem for us to come together and start thinking of how we organize at a larger systemic level? And there's, you know, whether that's a food system at a state level, helping a state look at its energy system, or a regional one, or a municipal level. So it's really I see it as kind of creating new organizational forms and structures that help us work at a more connected ecosystem level, or working within and across organizations to accelerate and amplify the work that everyone's doing. And really at the heart of this work is collaborative learning, and that's at the heart of long-lived companies, at the heart of, you know, ecosystems or species that evolve and adapt, is they are always sensing what's changing, how do we keep learning and trying new things and adapting. And so in terms of networks, the next slide really kind of is a picture of a traditional organizational model and a network way of thinking, but you know, a lot of people are starting to recognize that organizations can only take us so far, and that a lot of what's needed now is to line work at much greater scales. So when you think of how complex systems work, you know, we're trying to change incredibly complex systems. And in terms of climate change, it cuts across, you know, every facet of our economy, and gets into those, you know, those wicked problems of human behavior change and politics and everything. So one organization is not going to solve this. The problems are interdependent, like Forrest was mentioning. Climate also intersects into soil, into agriculture, into transportation. So we really need everyone who's part of the system to help kind of be able to come together and figure out how to look at solutions. We also recognize there's complex, fast-changing situations, and we really need to be adaptive and have ability to respond and have really strong social capital. So there's a whole field now of disaster sociology looking at how do communities react when there's a big event like a Katrina or a 9/11. And often the communities that can really respond effectively have very strong bonds of social capital already in place. And that's what I feel like part of this network building work is for climate responsiveness and adaptation, is the way we do our work can be, just in the course of trying to do what we're doing, we can be building that social capital every step of the way, which builds the adaptability and resilience for the uncertain future we face. And then the other part that I think, you know, in all my work in years in business and government and nonprofits, I think we're really have so much more potential for peer-to-peer learning and sharing than we really do. We have such an orientation to action and getting the job done. And there's, like we're doing tonight, I mean, there's just a huge potential to do more sharing across efforts. So just real quick, the idea with networks is, if you look on the left, it's a shift of approach. You know, we often think in funding circles, foundations have their strategy and they pick which nonprofits they want to invest in for all these sort of portfolio of grants. And what we're looking to, what the shift in approach is, and Jen's going to share the first story of this, is starting to say, you know, instead of thinking about it all as these little portfolio of different grants and initiatives and projects, we need to create containers that create conditions for aligned work and self-organizing. So they're oriented to a shared big goal, but that everyone can come together and see where they fit and where their work can help support work towards that big goal. And so the idea of funding and developing new structures and new ways of working together that support that network collaboration and collaborative learning is really what the heart of network work is about. So what tonight we'll share is what I often call fire starter stories as I'm working with clients about learning networked ways of working. I think that, again, sharing the stories to get spark their thinking is really helpful. So we're going to have Jen share the story of Energy Action Network in Vermont. And Jen, I think I'll just advance the slides as you tell me. That's all right. Which is kind of a system change focus, looking at the whole energy system statewide. But a lot of the principles can be applied in other kinds of changes. The second story I want to talk about is the Boston Green Ribbon Commission. So this is a great example of implementing a citywide climate action plan. Like that strategy approach is one a lot use, and we all probably have seen lots of effort go into city or state plans, and then the mayor or the governor changes, and the plan goes on the shelf, and the new person says, well, that was the previous guy's plan or woman's plan. I want to start my own, which makes me completely crazy. But so this Boston example is a good one to show how does civil society come forward and create a structure to make sure the plan gets implemented that can outlast one any mayor. And then another example, Boston Green and Healthy Building Network, that's an example of working with the advocates primarily. So some of you may be working more with those working to advance climate change and maybe not have a kind of platform to engage business or senior government. But this is a story that can show you the kinds of network approaches you can use. And then finally, a peer-to-peer community of practice example of a network. So in each, you'll see different ways that network principles and collaborative learning get applied and systems thinking. So Jen, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Beth. Thanks for the great introduction. And thanks for inviting me to be on this call. I'm excited to talk with you and share the story. So just a little bit about my background. I was a community organizer for about 10 years, working for the PICO National Network, and got really interested when I was organizing in the role of philanthropy and in this role, in this idea of bringing different groups together to really look at impact. I just saw a lot of the organizing I was doing. You know, there was just a lot of kind of infighting between organizing groups and saw the role that philanthropy was playing in that. So when I left organizing, I was hired in 2007 to be the director of a small family foundation in Vermont. And I've been in philanthropy ever since. I'm a consultant and doing work mostly on systems change work, actually with the Garfield Foundation. So I'm going to share the story of my work in Vermont at the Maverick Lloyd Foundation. It's a very specific example of both using a systems methodology and a networked approach to look at large scale change within a state context. So the Maverick Lloyd Foundation is a small family foundation, and by small, I mean we are doing about $250,000 a year, which I think is important, just understanding what the scale of the funding was. And I was hired to help them develop a funding strategy. Like a lot of small family foundations, the trustees had lots of interest, were kind of funding a scattershot approach, and had a long-term interest in funding climate energy issues, and were really frustrated with the status quo. So they saw a lot of redundancy between organizations working in the state and recognized that there was a lot more potential possible for the state than what was actually happening. And there was just a lot of complacency among different players in the state. Some people felt like, Vermont's doing great. We're already so far ahead of the rest of the country. And then some people were really frustrated between what they saw was the aspiration of Vermont and the reality. So as you can see in the slide, there was a lot of talk around like, what's the actual reputation of Vermont in terms of making progress on climate and energy issues? And then what's the reality? So I did a bunch of interviews with both funders and folks in the field, and part of what I really saw was that there was a lot of fragmentation. There was not agreement on what the problem was in Vermont or what the solutions were, and really no big vision or unification in terms of understanding where the state needed to go or wanted to go. So as a foundation, we got really interested in whether or not we could help create something bigger and create a more holistic vision for the state. I was really inspired. I had learned about the work that the Garfield Foundation was doing in the Midwest around climate energy issues, and the kind of vision and the process that they had used for creating system change really resonated with us. So there are lots of different ways to think about and talk about systems change. And the way that I talk about it and that we talked about it when I was at the foundation, that Garfield talks about it, is within a very specific framework. So I think there are a couple, you know, kind of four key points. There are three on this slide, but one, you know, I think systems work is really about bringing a diverse group of players together. So understanding that, you know, nonprofits alone can't address the scale of the problem we're trying to address. Government is not going to do it alone. And that, in fact, it actually takes a multi-sector approach. So you've got to have people, diverse perspectives representing government, nonprofits, and business at the table in order to address some of these large-scale complex issues that we're facing. We have to have a shared understanding of both the problem. What is it that we're trying to, you know, what's the cause of the problem, and agree on a goal and what the interventions are that are going to help get us to this big, hairy, audacious goal. I think systems change work also aligns the work of all those players around these couple interventions. It doesn't mean that everybody's doing the same thing, but that the work is moving together in the same direction. So in that last slide, you know, it's all these different arrows pointing in different directions. I think what systems work can help do is try to align the work of multiple players in a common direction. And then also it's about building the long-term infrastructures to support the change. So kind of using that framework, we hired some consultants and embarked on a journey that really led to Energy Action Network. So in the next couple slides, I'm gonna walk through the process we use. I just wanna warn you, this is technical. You don't have to understand it, but I think the slides are helpful in just giving you a sense of some of the processes that we use, and I think really help what we're illustrate what we're talking about when we talk about systems change. So we pulled together a small planning team of folks from government, business, and the nonprofit sector, and we agreed on a really ambitious goal. So we wanted to get Vermont to 100% renewable energy by 2030. So the question became, if we want to shift the state from this current system, which is actually working pretty well, but using non-renewable fossil fuels, what would need to change if we wanted to shift from the current dirty energy system to one that was powered by 100% renewable energy in 20 years? And if we're going to get there, what are the perspectives that we need to understand in the system? So one of the things I think about doing this kind of work is that it's often hard for us to see the bigger perspective of what's happening in a system from our particular vantage point. So as an advocate, for example, working on just renewable energy policy, I understand really well that part of the system that I'm working in, but oftentimes it's really hard to understand or actually to see the work that is happening in different parts of the system and what the contributions of those different players and perspectives are in terms of creating the current system we have. So the map that you see here was really just an illustration of what are the perspectives that we need to understand if we actually want to shift the system to one that's that is powered by 100% renewable energy in 20 years. So we looked at what are the perspectives we need to understand and who are the people who can help us understand those perspectives. So we identified 20 people who had expertise in these different areas, and our consultants did interviews with them to help understand their individual perspective. So how did they see their role in the system? What did they think from their viewpoint were the opportunities and challenges of getting to 100% renewable energy? So from each of these interviews, our consultant, you can go to the next slide, develop these individual systems maps. So you don't have to understand all of this, but basically this is the story of somebody who was representing the affordability perspective. So it was their understanding of what the dynamics are at play that are creating affordability or creating lack of affordability around renewable energy policy. So part of what's really interesting about this process is that in the interviews, the consultant is really trying to understand the story and the impact, develops a system map, and then shares it back with the person. In this case, it was the person who was sharing the affordability perspective. So the person can really see in a new way the story of their work. And this in and of itself is a really powerful part of the process in terms of helping people understand their perspective in a larger system. So once you have all these different perspectives, our consultant put them together. So this is a large complex map of about 20 different perspectives around basically what's happening in the renewable energy system in Vermont. So, you know, it's looking at what are the different key perspectives that are interrelating to generate the current system. And part of what's interesting about this is that once you see your individual map, you can see how your work and your perspective fits in with the work of all of these other players in the system. So that where the red circle is actually that is the affordability perspective. So part of what's really powerful about this process is that you have people who really have never worked together, who have expertise in different parts of the system, coming together to build a common picture and a common understanding of how do all of these things relate to create the current system that we have. It's a complicated system. It's really hard for people to understand, but part of what's important about it is that people can begin to see patterns and understand connections. And once you see that, you can develop a more simplified version of the map that helps summarize learnings and pull out key elements. So the map that you see now is basically a simplified version of this bigger complex map. But what's important about this is that the team of 20 people we had around the table were able to identify four key areas. So it was not 10 or 15 or 20 different places where we need to intervene, but there are four key areas that the group agreed on could help speed the transition from this old system to one that was generating 80% or 100% renewable energy by 2030. So one of the key learnings for folks in this process is that, you know, oftentimes we think about like moving on one area. So, right, we have to educate people about the role of renewable energy, but actually in order to transform the whole system, we have to be moving on several leverage points at the same time. And that actually is going to help speed the transition to a different kind of system. And that actually we don't need to be working in 10 or 20 or 30 different places. If you identify what the right, you know, kind of high leverage places are, you can focus work in a couple key areas in order to speed that transition. So once we had agreement on what the intervention points, we brought together groups to come up with short-term goals and action plans that could get the system moving in the short term, so 3 to 5 years. And what you see here is the structure that was then developed to begin to support that work. So the four key areas were public engagement, regulatory reform, capital mobilization, and technological innovation. And you can see, public engagement, the first thing that the group really wanted to do was think about message framing, how we create a statewide message that groups can align around. So I think the other piece, important piece about this work is that, it's both marrying the systems perspective, so understanding what's happening in the larger system and what the dynamics are, but then also being able to set up a long-term structure that is going to support the work. As Beth said at the beginning, there's a growing recognition that individual organizations can only take us so far. So we need different kinds of structures that are working together over the long term, coordinated in order to begin to shift these big complex systems. Beth, is there one more slide showing the structure?
This one.
Yeah. So this is kind of the strategy that captures kind of the network philosophy. So, you know, the planning was really the systems analysis where we're setting priorities for action, moving into implementation. So what are the particular action plans that the groups are going to be working on? being able to track and share progress, and then based on what we're learning and what's happening, being able to adjust strategies based on that. And then the network functions were really to provide what's below the facilitation and convening, some online collaborative tools, and then developing a dashboard to be able to monitor progress. I think I might stop there.
Great. So thank you, Jen. And one thing I would just point out, having worked with a number of networks on climate action, I think where EAN, I think it's one of the best examples I've seen of getting business. They had utilities at the table, they had government at the table, and nonprofits and advocates. So when you look at the four topic areas, based on that in-depth system analysis that they got to, like capital mobilization, like I really haven't seen other groups that are mostly environmentalists sitting around the table saying, how do we change systems? Usually won't focus in on the finance part as deeply, for example, or the technological innovation. So I think, I think that the robust understanding of the system then driving where the network focuses is a great example in this story.
Yeah, and I'll just say as a follow-up to this, we happened to finish this analysis and the planning at really the exact same time that the state was thinking about developing updating their comprehensive energy plan. And I basically took the work that we did, and that became the state's comprehensive energy plan. So the goal changed a little bit, but the goal, Vermont's energy goal now is getting to 90% renewable energy in all sectors by 2050. And that was a direct result of the analysis and the work that the network did. And it was interesting. I was just reading in an article in some philanthropic journal the other day about, Vermont has the most aggressive renewable energy goal of anywhere in the country. So, and I think that it was the function, it was partly a function of the type of people we had around the table that made the state very receptive to both the analysis, but also taking on, it wasn't just a group of advocates, but it was a really diverse group of people. And the governor and the energy folks in the state said, wow, if this group of really diverse people has agreed on this goal and is agreeing to this analysis, there's something to that. Actually, we don't need to do our own analysis. We can take this and adapt it a little bit. So there's something very powerful about bringing that diversity of folks around the table together.
Thanks, Jen. And I encourage you to look at EAN's Energy Action Network of Vermont. Look at their website. The network continues to this day. They've hired an executive director and a program coordinator, and work groups are working on all those areas, advancing things year in, year out, evolving the coordination to keep implementing this plan. So with that, I'm going to move to sharing another story. One other way, just in terms of theory, part of the other thing to think about with networks is really seeing it as aligning work at various scales. So I find this metaphor helpful of thinking about there's the work on the ground that the individual participants are doing. You might end up also with task forces to advance particular things. But what Jen just described is really helping everybody in that group look at what needs to happen kind of at the from the 10,000 foot view. And that's where this leverage point work and cross-cutting teams can provide work that needs to happen for the system to move forward that any one organization can't handle alone. And then there's a steering committee and network-wide gatherings where all the work groups connect and coordinate that work, since you need stuff moving on all four at the same time. And so the kind of strategic questions to ask that you keep asking in running these kind of networks is, what needs to happen collectively that individuals or organizations can't make happen on our own? Where is there work that needs to happen at a broader scale? And what do we need to do to change the system that's not happening? And so Andy, who's currently the executive director, she says their compass is to focus on identifying where we can use our connections and network to truly add value to the work that's underway. And it's hard work and it takes constant vigilance. So whoever's staffing the network and coordinating members to work together, you're always saying, what is the high value thing? I think of it also as like incubating. So, it was going to be helpful to develop, to invest in research, to model what would it take to get to the 2050 goals, how many electric cars, how many homes. So that's something the network invested in that every member could use. if there's other things that make sense for members to run with, the network doesn't get involved. So it's that vigilance to say what makes sense at a collective level. And so just the next question, the next story I want to tell is from Boston. So in Boston, they did a great participatory community engagement process to develop the city's climate action plan, some pretty ambitious goals. In Boston, we had Mayor Menino, for who has served five terms. So we had a long-term mayor who had been there in a long time. And there's a bar, there's a foundation called the Bar Foundation that invests quite millions of dollars in climate energy work in Massachusetts, founded by Amos Hofstadter, who made money in the cable business. So in looking at how do we actually implement the city's policy, I think they got this from Chicago, but they created a Green Ribbon Commission. So you had the chair and trustee of the Bar Foundation, Amos Hofstadter, and Thomas Bonino, the mayor. The two of them got together and said they wanted to create this commission. And you can see on the slide, or go to the Green Ribbon Commission website for Boston, that like they got all these big wigs from around the city. The Partners Healthcare, the CEO of that, it's 50,000 employees in the healthcare industry. They've got the Visitors Bureau, Suffolk Construction, university president. So they have about 50 senior people who are on the commission. And the idea is that these representatives from all the leading economic sectors will partner with the city to develop shared strategies for fighting climate change. So there's three things the commission does. They advise the city on implementing their plan. They individually, in their sectors, engage their leaders, and they engage their sectors in aligning their assets and initiatives to support the plan outcomes. So in Boston, they recognize this is also really data-driven. So they found, they knew that to get the city's greenhouse gas emission reduction goals, 50 of the largest commercial industrial properties in Boston accounted for 30% of the total emissions. So if Boston was going to have any chance of getting its citywide goals, they had to get those commercial industrial property owners to adopt aggressive climate goals within their own facilities and operations. So I think that's a really important connection that underlaid the philosophy of this. And the third part that the Green Ribbon Commission does is they highlight and promote best practice examples within and across sectors. And so you have these senior folks who all meet twice a year, and then they're like, yes, we're doing it. And then you have kind of the operational level within hospitals or universities who all then work in peer-to-peer groups actually implementing things. So really big team effort. You can imagine the peers want to be at the table with all their other peers, really ensuring that civic leadership makes sure this gets done. And so the commission is set up as a network. There's a book that I really recommend called Connecting to Change the World, which is all about network philosophy with lots of case studies. So actually one of the authors of this, John Cleveland, has been one of the staff and directors of the commission doing the work behind, in developing this. So the structure of the commission, they've got hubs, like they have little working groups on commercial real estate, healthcare, higher ed, like the healthcare group is run by a nonprofit called Healthcare Without Harm. So the Bar Foundation funding helps support the nonprofit that helps support the peer-to-peer network convenings and joint work data sharing across the sector to advance their practice. And then they also have a group working on the Greenovate, the common campaign messages, climate preparedness, and carbon-free Boston. And so in each of these, they have research, they recruit pace setters, they have really good sector data, like they're getting all the energy data from major hospitals all in one database so they can start benchmarking, comparing, seeing how they're doing. They get them all working together to work with the utilities to get the incentive programs right. They share best practices. They get amazing climate speakers into Boston, coming into a room with like 50 people you saw on that commission to talk about sea level rise, getting, so there's a lot of clout to this network. And it's really managed to get a lot of movement happening in the city on climate. I think there's a quote that there's a great case study online about this, but, the city's environmental person says, everyone has to own the goal. And it's really also this idea of the expertise that the city is not going to be able to tell a hospital how to get a 20% emission cut. So they really need the hospitals working with their peers and working with experts from around the country who know how to do energy efficiency in a hospital environment. It's incredibly challenging. The city gets this constant feedback from those communities, because otherwise we're sitting in a room throwing darts at a wall hoping the policies work. So I think both in this story and the one Jen shared, you can see there's a network approach, and there's also a real robust attention to the systems and the philosophy of how are we making the change, and let's base it on data, base it on a good systems understanding. And so another aspect of networks that I think is really important to think about is the network is really this space where people, like organizations of all sorts or individuals, they can come together and work together to help achieve their own goals, and then come together and achieve shared goals more effectively. And it generates a lot of other benefits. So we often think of networks as, okay, we're all going to come together and do better on some big goals. But it's also this amazing spaces where the connections and the access to the talents and gifts and expertise within the community gets better shared. New ideas emerge out of the connections between the parts that you would never have thought of. So for example, I help facilitate a climate action, a statewide network in Massachusetts that's a lot of the environmental health energy advocates working to make sure Massachusetts does their plan, you know, gets their targets met. And, you know, we had a group come to that network gathering, hear what was going on in the state, fighting pipelines, you know, the legislation, where things were at. And that group had a lot of research capacity, so that by being at the quarterly network meeting, they heard what was needed. They went back, figured out a research piece of data that would really help advance all those working on the ground for better legislation and fighting the pipelines. And they went off and found some funding, did the research, and brought it back to the next network meeting. You know, there was the data, and everyone was like, the grassroots people like, thank you, I didn't even know to ask for this. But so that's like this great example of that organization got clear what it could do to contribute to the bigger goal, and it helped the whole network really advance everybody's work. And so I think that's a really important piece of what networks start to enable. And then also realizing there's lots of micro collaborations and small world connections where I can help you, you know, I give you access to this decision maker, things like that. And then, you know, just can't appreciate enough how much the stronger relationships and trust, once that gets established and built within a network, things, I call it like moving at the speed of trust. Things can happen so quickly, and information can get exchanged so rapidly across a complex system. And I've just continued to be amazed when you see it finally, you know, after a couple years of building the network and the platforms for exchange, you know, how things can really start to combine and move and go quickly once you have those relationships and trust built. And so along those lines, just one other piece on the philosophy, you know, that the idea of networks is it's all based on that connectivity. So the foundation is really building trusting relationships and ways for people to meet and connect across different parts of a system or a network. Or if, you know, if it's churches, you know, how are different groups at churches all finding ways to connect to each other, looking at how to align and coordinate that work. And that's all based within kind of a system understanding, the opportunity to aggregate knowledge across a lot of different people, like Jen talked about, peer-to-peer learning and collaborative learning over time. Like, so we saw that collaborative learning cycle at the heart of the work. And then all that foundation enables you to create the most effective collaborative action and the most effective individual action with a better understanding of the whole. The dynamic that I find I'm up against a lot with doing network work is sort of unlearning traditional ways people are trained to work, which is to skip over the first two steps and focus on producing collaborative action as the urgent thing. So to build relationships, build trust, do all that system learning together is critical to actually get to the most effective places to intervene and find how you can combine all the pieces most effectively to get something done. But you are often up against toe tappers and those impatient with process. So that's where a lot of my creative work has to come in terms of training people in how to work in collaborative network ways for larger scale change. So I want to just pause there and open it up to some questions before we go to some of the other examples, particularly while we have Jen here. Would love to hear any questions or comments or things you have about the stories or points so far.
I have a question. This is Rick. And I'm thinking particularly of the Green Ribbon Project, just as one example. When you're first trying to create the network, now you said you had, like in one case, you had Bar Foundation funding. One of the things that seems to be most critical is who's the convener? Who's the inviter? Who's the first mover acting? Because that tends to influence the point of view of others relative whether or not they're going to even tentatively join in. Do you have any advice on that?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. Jen, would you like to answer that one?
I think it's a really important point. I mean, the networks that I've been part of have really been initiated by foundations, which I think have pros and cons. I think one of the benefits, certainly, of the way that we convened and initiated the work in Vermont was that although we were a funder, we were really seen as a neutral party. The foundation hadn't taken a really political role in the state. So in terms of thinking about a big audacious goal in the state related to renewable energy, people didn't necessarily look at Maverick Lloyd and say, oh, you know, it's a really ideological foundation, or it's just those like green environmentalists over there, and there's no way that I'm going to have anything in common with them. So from that perspective, I feel like the foundation platform was a really important platform from which to begin to initiate this kind of collaborative work. I think it also has some, you know, downsides, which are important to, you know, keep in mind, which is, you know, it is a foundation asking people to come together. There are all kinds of power dynamics in that. But I do think that regardless of who the convener is, the neutrality question is a really important one, particularly if you want diversity within the network. I think it's really hard. You know, we, for example, we had IBM, who was the biggest employer in Vermont, as part of our initial circle. It would have been really hard for IBM to come in the conversation if it had been convened by a bunch of advocates, frankly. They would have looked at the group and said, there's no way we ever will have anything in common with them. But because of the way that we invited them and the way we framed the conversation, it created the space for kind of a more diverse group of folks to come to the table.
Yeah, and I can say I've also watched small environmental nonprofits step up and want to be the convener role. There's been a big article called Collective Impact that named the convener role with this idea of backbone support. So you also saw a lot of different nonprofits all saying, that's our gravy train ticket to be a backbone. One of the challenges I see a lot is someone who's trained as an environmental advocate, who really has a point of view and is really looking at ways to sustain their grant funding as the motivation for a network, or like run the network as just one of their programs, that also can really be challenging, because the convener really needs to be holding the neutral space, as Jen said, and not have its own organizational agenda, you know, kind of getting mixed up in supporting what the network needs. So that's another piece.
And I would say also, just from a foundation, if the funder is a convener, I've seen this work in both ways. And I think for whatever reason, and actually there, because we didn't just have our grantees at the table, I think one of the dynamics to just think about is, you know, that people also are coming to the table in some of these networks because they see it's a place to get money. And I think in order for the network to be really successful, the value proposition has to be, you know, together we are going to be able to do something much greater and much more ambitious than any one organization can do together. It actually can't be around, okay, this is a place where I can get money. But it's about this kind of bigger aspirational goal of what's the long-term thing that we're trying to do together that we can do better because we are together.
So Beth and Jen, I wanted to, I don't know if it's a question as much as a comment. This has been a very in-depth and insightful and wonderful presentation. And it's been leading me to think about, you know, how we tend to use words in such different ways. And I think it's fascinating to hear about multi-sector, multi-stakeholder networks to accomplish change in a particular geographical area, such as the state of Vermont or the city of Boston. And that's really powerful, inspiring, and wonderful. And like here in our call, we're using the word network in a slightly different way, which I think is also a valid thing when we're talking about like a network of peer support that doesn't necessarily need to be multi-sectoral, but like in our case, we are wanting to network together facilitators who are working on climate change issues as primarily a learning together and connectivity. I'm not even sure that we would be aligning on something or producing something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so it's a little different. And I think what you're saying is totally useful because many of our members have multiple roles and multiple hats, and the information you've shared can be lots and lots of ways. I'm just kind of trying to understand if maybe sometimes coming up with new words might be helpful. So I don't know if we're like a proto network or an affinity network or a, you know, I'm almost done. There's just one more thing, which is that I'm realizing that when you have a geographical focus like that, it's a little bit easier to say, okay, we need a green ribbon panel of 60 people, 20 from each of the sectors, and who are the highest, you know, most powerful players in that. And sometimes with these other kinds of, I don't know, affinity networks or proto networks or learning networks, it's like we're not exactly trying to, because the geographical area is so broad, we're not exactly trying to have a fixed amount of people, and so it makes it a little bit more diffuse, and so it's just different. So I'm just curious what your comments would be.
Well, it's a great question, and I think in that triangle graphic I showed, your network purpose can focus just on connectivity or can focus just on alignment. So it might be good to share the other story I was going to share, which is the Urban Sustainability Directors Network, which is much more to the design of a purpose like you're sharing, Rosa. Which,
yeah, and I'll just really quickly think the book that Beth showed you, the Madeline, the Connecting for Change, is a really nice illustration of the different kinds of networks. And as Beth said, you know, USDN is a really good example of more of an information sharing network. But part of what Madeline and Pete and I can't remember who the third author is. Yeah, layout is that, you know, these networks have different functions and different purposes, and they're valid and they have different purposes. So I would say that more the work that I was talking about is, I think, what they refer to as more of a strategic action network, or what we're starting to refer to as a strategic action network. And I think one of the things that we're seeing, your point about language, is really important, that over the past couple of years, everybody's starting to talk about networks. And so what does that actually mean? And do we have the same definition? And, you know, yes, there are different functions of networks for different things, but being clear about what that is.
Thanks so much.
I actually have to jump off, so I'm sorry I can't stay on, but thank you,
Jen.
Opportunity. Yeah.
Thanks. Okay, so I'll keep going. I'll just tell the USDN story because I think it shows another, it's a different structure, but similar principles. So Urban Sustainability Directors Network was created as a vehicle to connect sustainability directors in cities across the country. And its aim is to really allow members to learn with each other, collaborate, and co-create to advance, you know, sustainable cities. And so some of the elements and structures they put in place to do this, so this is cities across the country. It's about 135 members. They actually, you actually have to apply, and they cap it at a low number. So when you become a member, you have to commit to really being an active member. And if you are shown over time, they kind of track, are you interacting on the online platform? Are you participating in work groups? Are you coming to the network meetings, the annual summit? And if you are a member, but you're actually not participating, they actually ask you to leave and give another city that place because they really want this to be an active peer-to-peer network. And so some of the elements they do, and this is, I developed this story a few years ago, so some of their stuff may have evolved since, but there's some great articles they've shared online, and this book has a lot of stories of them. But they would have a weekly e-newsletter with lots of updates and things, and their network coordinator would track who was clicking on what to see which issues and topics were of interest to the members. They would, over time, they'd always survey the members every year to say what issues and topics are most of interest to you. And based on the members' ideas and current priorities, they would then develop a discussion marketplace where people could come together and join small group discussions virtually. And then out of that, also, they would develop work groups. They might develop, say, a joint, like some work group might come together to say, what are the, you know, what's a best practice for issuing an RFP for electric vehicle charging stations? Or, you know, what's the best way to develop a greenhouse gas emission inventory for your city? And so whatever was up for people, and they would create the work groups and different city leaders would work on those, supported with some coordination support from the network. And it was every year they start fresh. So if people said they want a work group on something, but then they didn't join it, you know, they won't do it next year. So very member driven. And then they also developed this innovation fund. In addition, they also have regional networks and this has all been emergent. This is the other thing with network. You know, you start out and you constantly find out what do the members need and want, and you keep evolving the formats and the structures based on what the members want. So the need for regional ones that could expand to more cities, that's now evolved over time. And then I'll just want to share the innovation funding. So they have a big annual gathering where everyone comes together in person is another key part of what they do. And innovation funding supports joint work. And so they created this innovation system to support members collaborating and spreading what works, really. So through the survey and the annual gathering, the members choose the priority areas. They have a steering committee that helps support this. The regional networks also identify promising innovations. And then based on all that input, they'd put out a RFP for collaborative projects relating to those priority areas. And then the innovation funding from foundations and things would support consultants and work and time and expenses or whatever for the cities to work on those projects together. And back to the learning, collaborative learning frame, you know, they would then pilot things, refine, replicate, and share them, developing tools that could be shared out to the whole network. So I think that's an example, to your point, Rosa, of like one model of how to help different people come together, meet, connect, work together. They also have a pretty robust like online profile. You can send a question to everyone in the network, you know, tracking collaborative, you know, tracking learning over time around issues and tools developed before, so others can search that sort of knowledge base of information. And so just a few principles, again, back to the kind of seeing how much networks are like living systems, you know, wherever possible, helping people see the system and visualize who's in the network, understanding where they can tap expertise or see how their work connects to other work. Putting, as I mentioned, this collaborative learning and sense-making at the center. Creating conditions for emergence, which is, you know, my piece can connect to your piece, and, you know, that's how change really starts to happen. And I love the principle from Jeff Jarvis of, you know, the idea that in a network, you get to do what you do best and link to the rest. And what you do best might be six different ways and roles you can show up. And you're really trying to create this ethic of a federation of mutual exchange. So this also takes some learning about, you know, you sort of give and you invest in the field and you hope to get stuff back, but it's not all transactional. You're really trying to encourage a lot of sharing and investment in the larger whole. So we talk about kind of wearing two hats. You're looking out for your own self-interest and you're looking out for the health of the whole. So I want to just pause there again for questions. I'm minding the time. I know I've covered a lot, but that gives you kind of another example of what a network structure could look like with a slightly different peer learning purpose. So other questions or comments? And yeah, Linda?
Well, I've been taking notes, but what really hit me about what you just said is the amazing opportunity for changing, I think you mentioned this in the beginning, changing mindsets around the traditional way of thinking about work, which is more individually oriented. So I love it from just a sort of a cultural change opportunity. It just like that's what we need. We need opportunities where people do just lower the ego and lower this idea that it's all about me, not about we. So it's just so exciting for me to I don't really have a question, just to comment.
Yeah, and I agree. That's where I get so excited about this. And I added another slide on there about leadership with a network mindset, because it to me, it's very much about shifting the culture of how we work together. And, you know, it also, you know, instead of hierarchy and just a few people at the top have all the information and get to decide things, and there's all these people left out or who are just like supposed to be implementers. I mean, to me, it's networks are what unleash the potential of human creativity and opportunities to collaborate. And it's also from an equity frame, really exciting because everyone can find a place to fit in. It's not just a few at the top who get the good jobs. It's like, no, we find a way for everyone. Everyone can be a leader. People can, you know, champion something and find others to work on it with them. So it just becomes very fluid and adaptive.
This is David in Tampa. May I make a comment?
Sure.
The last couple minutes have been the most exciting part. And I think because the vocabulary that has come up in the last few minutes, including the word equity, including collaborative learning, I think is so significant. I participate in numerous networks here, Network Spiritual Progressives, Pachamama Alliance, Climate Mobilization. And I find that the difficulty often is related to how people perceive their own learning process. In other words, there's some groups that meet and have dialogue and small group discussion. Other climate groups meet and have a speaker and just announcements. And we all learn in different ways. We have different learning styles. And I find the most frustrating is when I send out invitations to educational events, the opportunity to learn about new aspects of this. And people seem to, those who attend or do not attend, perceive that it's not in their self-interest of their silo, or they have a different theory of change that precludes from them wanting to go out and do some collaborative learning. And just as a final thing for those who have been in education, Paulo Freire, Brazilian educator, spoke about raising consciousness through dialogue so that we act upon our environment. That is the word praxis. So just to leave with you the fact that if you do another event like this, I think that we're on a very good track to be able to talk about how we communicate and build trust and learn among each other. I think that would be the strongest way to keep these groups very strong.
This is Ted Wysocki in Chicago at ICA. I have a question for you, Beth. In the case studies you were sharing, here in Chicago, ICA has been working over the last several years with the Chicago Sustainability Director, and I've had an opportunity to meet at least four others that are probably members of the Urban Sustainability Directors Network. Mm-hmm. And we've been interacting with our Chicago person with a whole range of community leaders through the Chicago Sustainability Leaders Network. So we have our own network of Chicago community leaders. And part of what we have landed up describing this as is sort of the in-between space where we're able to share the community-based initiatives on sustainability and climate action with the sustainability director. Now, we just had a changeover in our sustainability director here in Chicago, but we've met a couple times now already with the new person, and he found it very helpful to kind of see some consensus building from the communities about what the city should have in. I'm just wondering, in the case studies and or even other ones you have that you didn't get a chance to share today, mm-hmm. are you seeing that kind of network where you're connecting the city government with the communities?
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll just show you a few pictures. One other one I didn't share was the Boston Green and Healthy Building Network, which was a bunch of nonprofits in Boston who wanted to influence how the city's green building or healthy building processes were working. And in this case, a foundation pulled the nonprofits together, partly because they were also aware that about 8 different nonprofits were all coming in asking the city to do different things, often the same things, right? And so in that case, there's a map here that was an example of who knew who at the first meeting of these nonprofits. And we realized, you know, the blue dots on the map are city people, and a lot of these environmental and health nonprofits didn't really know them. And after a couple years in the network, we were able to map it again and see all these dense levels of relationships. And part of that work was the nonprofits aligning and figuring out, what do we all want? Who's offering what? You know, we realized 7 different nonprofits were all advocating green building standards that were different, or healthy building standards. So the nonprofits actually made an effort to align all their requests and work with the city to get one really good set of green and healthy building standards. So I think that's a lot of the work that the community advocate piece can do to be stronger and speak with more of a collective voice, or, you know, getting diverse allies at the table who all can agree to things. It makes a much stronger collective voice for the city. And in the example that Jen shared, I've been at EAN network meetings like the second year on the annual meeting. And in that case, you know, the state government was like, can we get on your agenda? Because they're like a standing stakeholder group of, like, the state doesn't have to invest in doing all that stakeholder engagement, because EAN's like a standing stakeholder, multi-diverse, everyone you want to ask is in the room. So it's pretty cool that way. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Beth. I thought you had some stories to share. This is a great chart to show that growth.
Yeah. And we did some mapping, you know, surveying of the network of who's working on what kind of buildings and what kinds of, where does our work overlap, so you can see what we needed to align and where we could, you know, combine our expertise to be helpful to the city.
Yeah.
Other questions or thoughts?
Beth, I just want to you know, repeat your invitation. I think this is a wonderful opportunity for us to look at either what has struck you from the stories that you might take with you into your other work, and also, if anybody wants to go there, what from what you've seen, this could be the opportunity for people to also talk about what kind of a network do you want this to be. So either way, whether it's in the rest of the work that you're doing or in these monthly calls, I think that we've gotten a lot of input that could be very interesting and valuable to reflect on.
This is Grady. I found the presentation very rich. I'm still letting it sink in. I particularly appreciated Rose's question about the meaning of the word network as it's illustrated in the examples. I think my experience with it and in some ways my expectation was in a somewhat looser, less intentional notion of network. So if one is starting from an organizational base, just sort of reaching out beyond the silos, but I hadn't quite appreciated or anticipated that you would be describing examples that were, were projects in a way, sort of network-oriented projects, as opposed to simply working from an organizational base with a somewhat more network-oriented mindset. And I'm just thinking about that. Just struck by the possibly the different models of how to take advantage of the network framework.
Thank you, Grady. I have a question for Mike, actually. I was really struck by what you had said, that in your hometown of Chicago, there is a director who's a member of the Sustainability Directors Network, and then you have a group of community activists who are maybe networked with each other. So as Beth was saying, because you guys are networked with each other, so was that Mike or was that someone else?
It was Ted.
It was Ted. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. That's fine.
And so because those activists were networked with one another, they were able to have access to this sustainability director. Is that close?
Right. Right. It started off with actually a very my predecessor. I don't think he understood how large a service learning project he was designing, but when it was all said and done, there were 250 college students from five universities who documented 900 community-based sustainability initiatives. And in 2012, ICA organized a fair share of those, maybe about 150, 175 people, and the sustainability director was the keynote speaker. And that started a relationship with her. And then over the last couple of years, we've been meeting about three times a year. And a year ago at the summer meeting, she pointed out that the current city plan was going to end in 2015. And in 2016, they had to develop a new one. And she actually encouraged us to come back with ideas. And so we used our facilitation methods to do a consensus workshop and came back with a four-page full of ideas. You can appreciate that our memo started off with core values, and that was what we were able, when the woman we were working with left the city, we were able to walk in on the first week of the new person's job and say, your predecessor had asked us to develop this, and now we just met with him last week, and he wants to talk about doing a couple community meetings in the fall. So it evolved over several years, but it provided substance to the dialogue and feeding those ideas.
That's wonderful. And it started with a project where you said 250 college students from 90.
Right. From five universities identified 900 community initiatives. We called the project Accelerate 77. There are 77 census tract communities in Chicago. And that's the project was called Accelerate 77, but we currently are still having a Chicago Sustainability Leaders Network that in many ways, like Beth was describing, kind of has its own rules of engagement, if you would, and we're meeting, they're meeting bi-monthly to continue sharing, the peer sharing that Beth was talking about, as well as what do we do with these new people at City Hall.
Wow. Amazing. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Other highlights or thoughts for you on today's call?
Beth, I guess I'm kind of curious, if you were going to start in a brand new city, let's say you moved to some city and you weren't involved with sustainability efforts, how would you look for a funder or foundation to support what you talked about in terms of Boston and Vermont? Like, where would you go? Is there a source of these philanthropic organizations that might be researched or?
I would probably look at, I mean, it's I would say it's a small but growing group of foundations interested in these network models, but there's still a lot that I don't think get it yet. I can say most of my work's in New England, so I've had the Boston Foundation, like, so the local community foundations are getting more into this. United Way's are a lot of them trying to change their whole strategies around to be more of a convener role on larger scale work on the systemic causes of poverty and things. And then just look at, like, the Bush Foundation in the Midwest is huge on networks. Garfield Foundation, Packard. So there's, you know, the GEO, Grant Makers for Effective Organizations, is one of the philanthropic networks. The Edge Funders is another one. I'd look at people who are members of those. And just trying to find, you know, and finding foundations that would be interested in trying this philosophy. And to me, there's also a really important part of this, which is really having an ethic of experimentation and innovation. So that you're trying things, you're evolving and you're adapting. And a lot of the ways foundations work is you kind of have to have all these desired outcomes and a whole kind of like set up plan for exactly what you're going to do. And networks work really differently. You don't know that till you get the network together and decide what you want to do together. So that's an important thing with philanthropy, is to get that aligned early.
Thank you.
Jan, Karen, some of these folks who we aren't seeing your face because you're on the phone, just want to open some space in case you want to share something. I don't know if people are typing on the, because Jan was typing earlier okay. So I'm curious what people found most interesting or exciting or puzzling or new about this way of looking at networks. Or maybe it's not new, maybe it's a celebration of something that you already enjoy and are doing, but a particular takeaway for the call?
This is Rick. So, I mean, speaking for myself and my practice, I knew about the importance of whole system change, but I think that this picture, this networking view of what whole system really means, expands my thinking about what the whole system is. I'd often think about what's the relevant whole system in a particular situation. And that was probably too confining, definitely too confining given climate change initiatives, because we're all in. So this is a very expansive, thought-provoking, challenging set of stories. Thank you.
I think this is Grady. I think I'm going away with a question. You know, with Rick and others, I'm working on building what we've called a chapter in Massachusetts of a national organization, and we're the first ones to do that locally. And it only recently began to occur to me, thanks in part to Deborah Meehan of the Leadership Learning Collaborative, whose organization just sponsored a webinar with Beth Tener last Friday, where I had an introduction to some of these ideas, or a reminder of some of them. It began to occur to me and others that perhaps it was a mistake to think in terms of a chapter, which implies an organizational model, and we might do well to think in terms of, well, in more network-like terms. And I think the question I'm coming away with is, to what extent, in shifting towards that mindset, is it important to map the system? Because it isn't, you know, climate change, the number of climate change organizations in the Boston area, as Beth would know better than I, is huge. to what extent to try to map that system, or simply, or alternatively, just start reaching out more proactively to have networking-like relationships with other members of the system. And so to what extent should it be a project? So to what extent is it just a mindset that shapes a little bit more who you seek out opportunities to talk with and so forth, more informal? So that's I'm sure there's no single right answer to that question, but I'm posing it.
Yeah, that's an interesting thought, Grady. And what that brings up for me is I remember reading E.F. Schumacher a long time ago, and he said he called his book Small is Beautiful because he saw so many things that were big, and that if everything in the world was small, he might have titled his book Big is Beautiful. So I'm just kind of curious about to what extent it's context dependent. I mean, it's wonderful to have networks of organizations, but if in some cases, if there is no organization that is doing what you're doing, you may want to create an organization and then have that organization be part of a larger network. So I'm curious about, in a given situation, whether it may be context dependent, whether there's more of a need for a network or more of a need for an organization that isn't, because there isn't one that is taking care of that particular need. And so in your case specifically, I don't know if amongst the millions of sustainability organizations in Boston, there is one that is specifically focused on doing outreach to older people. And so it may be the case that there is still a need for an organization whose perspective would be very much strengthened, or whose influence would be very much increased if it could then feed its perspective into a network. Right? Because the point of the network would seem to be to increase the leverage of all the members in it.
Right.
The other, this is Rick, just one further thought, since I know this situation that Grady's referring to. It is a very large group of environmental related organizations, but it would only be a node on one of the maps that you shared, because it doesn't include all the other kinds of actors in the broader system that are going to impact Massachusetts' long-term sustainability plans, greenhouse gas plans, et cetera. We aren't really well connected outside. We're struggling to connect as a group of environmental activists, but outside that, I mean, that's only one part of this network, as you were describing, painting those pictures.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, so I think of it as like, you know, it's like a niche in an ecosystem, like you do what you do best, you know, but then the network mindset questions are, you know, I always try to see the system. So who are the other players? You know, like the Climate Action Network I've been working with in Massachusetts, that's a statewide advocate one called Global Warming Solutions Project, like that enabled that. We have members on the Green Ribbon Commission. So when that, all those activists are now in a network space connected to the power of that commission, like, and now we added a link that's the power of the grassroots. So, you know, what the networks can network. and then there's also, I would think for an organization like yours, Grady, it's also what's the map of all the different networks and organizations involved with elders, not to do with environment, but like you are a link to all those organizations and bringing, you know, you think about these in network maps, you have the linking pieces, right? So you're at the periphery perhaps of the environmental, you know, hub of that, and then the industry and all that, but you're also a link to all these other organizations. And bring things across. So that's a great organizational role to play, right?
Right. Thank you.
Beth, we have this organization in Tucson that's made up, and I think you said something about this, so I'm just a little curious if you have any advice. We have this organization that has maybe 20 plus sustainability organizations. They come together once a month strictly for information sharing, and I've often thought, well, that's good, but they're not doing anything. So I keep thinking as a next possible step, if they could see themselves as one larger mm-hmm. networked organization. I think you or Jen mentioned that there was another group you were working with like that, that finally came together and created like a you know fuller vision. It would almost be like the citizen voice, because none of these groups are necessarily tied into government, you know, in any way.
Mm-hmm.
So would that be a natural evolution? And then out of that, possibly there might be some way to promote some even larger vision. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, that's where you have to see what there's energy for, but that's where I'd probably do like a world cafe around, you know, what can we do together that we can't do alone?
Right.
You know, what kind of collaborative initiative would you be really excited to work on and be willing to invest time in to work with your peers on, and see is there appetite for it? Is there, see what comes out of the group?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's probably how I'd tackle it, and not assuming that there is, but just seeing if people want to do that. Because I've also seen people try to push towards that with a group that actually doesn't have the time, resources, or energy to really do much collaboratively. Mm-hmm. And it can be very frustrating if you don't have the resources to staff it and stuff, you know, so.
Yeah, this is great, Beth. I didn't realize this was going to turn into an opportunity for each of us to consult with you on different projects. This is amazing. I don't have a specific project to ask you a question about, but I want to build a little bit on what Linda just said here. And pointing to also what you had said earlier, that you were involved in or helped form or know about this Global Warming Solutions Project in Massachusetts, which is a network of activists, and then that project has just somehow gained a seat or a voice in this Green Ribbon Commission in Boston that you had talked about earlier. And so I'm curious about how that Global Warming Solutions Project started. Did it start along the same lines of what you just shared with the cafe?
Yeah, actually, that one was also Bar Foundation. So they're funding a lot of climate action work in Massachusetts. Uh-huh. And about 6 years ago, and I was involved in the early formation. And so they had a consultant do stakeholder interviews and do, we actually did a network map, and we looked at this could be useful for some of your work, you know, like what are all the tables where people are coming together around anything to do with climate or energy, you know, so there's like an energy efficiency alliance of business groups, and there's, you know, the Massachusetts Smart Growth Alliance. And so we mapped what were those and which organizations were members, and got a whole picture of all the different organizations out there, and we could see which were environmental ones and which were business ones. And so we could see what did the field need. And so out of that, it became clear. It took several years for the network to get clear on the purpose it wanted to be. But the foundation supported my support in terms of strategy and facilitation and network mapping. And then that one nonprofit was given the coordination grant to convene quarterly meetings. And it just evolved over time to be a place for mostly those working on the advocacy to come together and align their work. And in the meantime, BAR was also funding the Mass Smart Growth Alliance, another kind of big cross-sector network on transportation called Transportation for Mass, Green Ribbon Commission. So they had about 5 networked hubs that connect their grantees to work in networked ways at a bigger scale. And we've developed a map showing all the network, a bunch of organizations are members of multiple ones. Oh, and Green Justice Coalition. So we would have meetings of all those network coordinators to make sure all of our stuff was connecting and overlapping. But it was really exciting, you know, when it came time for advocacy on Beacon Hill about energy efficiency legislation, you know, there was this one time we had the Chamber of Commerce marched in and was like, this is terrible and businesses all against it. But because the hospitals were really involved in Green Ribbon and through our connections with global warming, you know, we were able to get some hospital bigwigs to come in to these committee hearings and say, we want good energy efficiency, you know, investments and commitments. And to it, you know, and they were like, what's the chamber doing saying that we want that, you know? So it was really exciting to see where you could start getting, because of the trusting relationships and the generated commitment from these different groups, really starting to get different voices, powerful voices supporting the agenda.
There's another great example called California Delivers that was a communications-focused, common messaging-focused thing that brought clean energy businesses, you know, municipalities, advocates, everyone who cared about clean energy, they all galvanized together, and then the foundation supported communications, messaging, PR support to get a common message to fight those trying to use the ballot to roll back the California climate commitments. And so there's a lot of different vehicles you can use to draw people together. But I think the climate world really needs to overcome the fragmentation and, you know, find ways to work across.
Well, so thank you. That's I'm glad you're sharing more stories beyond the first two, which were wonderful and awesome. And it was great to see the detail. And now I feel like I'm kind of getting a broader picture in terms of some mm-hmm. of, you know, how it connects with the activism. And I guess the one thing that is it is coming up for me in terms of the shift in thinking mm-hmm. is that, you know, if someone is not really involved in the field, it can seem initially like there's not much happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, here's issues with climate. You don't hear on the daily news, hear all these people who are working to change this issue. And a lot of times, activist groups tend to be going out feeling like there's not much happening, so they tend to focus on the bad stuff. They're not saying, oh, there's all these networks over here that are working to change the issue. How can you get involved? They're more saying there's a problem and we need to do something about it. So the message is often that there's not enough being done, which I think in some ways maybe it may be accurate to say we can always use more, right? But so maybe part of the shift is saying maybe it's not that not enough is being done. Maybe part of what needs to happen is that the word needs to get out more about the good stuff that is happening and the different people who are working on contributions need to be networked even more. We need to weave even more of a web amongst all of the people who are already doing work.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. And just looking where I get excited about networks as the next evolution of how we collectively organize ourselves. I think that's absolutely right. Like, you know, individuals, and I was guilty of it. I got the sustainability bug and I'm like, I want to found a nonprofit. I want to create a 501c3 and we got our vision and we're going to solve it, you know, which in some wise sage leader in the field said, don't start a nonprofit, but I did. and running a nonprofit takes so much energy and so much time. And it's frankly, it sapped a lot of my passion for working on the cause. So I feel like if we have really well-established network structures and people are super connected, like in Vermont, there's a farm-to-plate network, which I really encourage you to take a look at that on the food system. It's incredible. 300 organizations statewide, 10-year plan to double local food production. So I'm at a statewide network conference of that, and there's a, you know, the, every part of the food system has a work group and they're connected really densely. So there's a young woman who just moved to Vermont, had great skills on marketing. She could come into the network, join that work group, learn everybody who are key players and start to see where she could fit like that, as opposed to, oh, I want to go figure out a way to help this big problem. And everyone independently is doing it instead of like you do the market or the system market research, the system view of what's needed. And then people can see where they can fit into the whole, into like those four leverage groups. You know, a lot of smart people have thought through, we need public education. This is where you can fit with your passions and your skills, as opposed to everyone independently trying to like do what they want to do to solve the problem, you know? Yeah.
Love it. Well, listen, I'm going to move us on unless there's any other burning question for Beth.
I'll just mention my website. It's ndcollaborative.com. So, you know, sign up for our newsletter. I blog about this stuff. There's a lot of blogs and a resource page. And I did another webinar about transitioning your organization to a network mindset that was done with Leadership Learning Community. And that's recorded. And the most recent blog has a lot of links in there that are great too. So thanks for all being here tonight and the opportunity.
Thank you, Beth, so much. This was so rich. I cannot believe how great this was. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we're going to try something different today as we move towards our checkouts. If you all can go to the note page, unfortunately I lose the visual, but if can all of you do that, move to the note page? Yes? Okay. So let's just take a very short moment of silence and just write down on the note page in your own words any takeaways, anything you would like to follow up with other people on. That way we'll have it in our notes and we can go back and refer to it. So I'm just going to give you just 1 minute and then we'll do a checkout round. Okay, well, please keep on going, but I'd like to open it up for anyone to share any top-of-the-mind takeaway with the others or anything, for that matter, that you'd like to mention in the group, anything that's going on. Who would like to go? Just raise your hand. We just have about 10 more minutes. Any kind of sharing. I would like to do, actually, I'll start. I would like to encourage anyone who's going to be at the NCDD conference to let any of our co-hosts know if you're going to be there and if there's anything that you would particularly like to share if we get a session going out of our DD CAN. I know a few of us are thinking about that, so please let any of us know. We have to get a proposal into Sandy by, I think it's the 8th of July, so let us know. Okay, who'd like to share any sort of takeaway? Big aha moment or anything else? Of course, we can always go back now and read the notes. And I will, we are making a recording of this, so we'll get that up as soon as we can. I know a lot of people want to be on this call, and not everybody can in terms of busy schedules.
Yeah, I'll just say that my big aha was just, again, realizing how much wonderful work is going on that we may not otherwise hear about. So it's just invigorating and inspiring and really, really good to have the opportunity to hear the stories.
Yeah, I would second that. This is Grady. and being somebody who's in the Boston area and to in Massachusetts, to hear the examples that were very close to home, but which I didn't know about, was really interesting. And then this is just kind of a personal resonance. I noticed that in two of the examples, I recognized the names of former clients with whom it would be fun to speak and get their perspective on those networks. So that was an unexpected icing on the cake.
This is Rick. Just to second Grady, and it's been a great learning. And then the other part of this is that 10, maybe 12 years ago, I was a part of an effort in Boston that died at birth, trying to convene multiple actors to begin working on the environment. I won't even mention the organization. We had a very diverse group of organizations, but it brought up that whole convener issue, and we never got very far. So it's wonderful to see these stories of success. I know how complex it can be. Thank you.
This is Ted in Chicago. I want to thank Beth for all the stories she shared with us today and inspiring us to be thinking outside the box as we're looking at connecting with other networks. Just one thing, I'm getting used to using Zoom versus Adobe Connect, so I think I put my comments or follow-up in teleconference chat because I'm not seeing them on, I don't know whether they were supposed to go in site-wide chat, but I'll defer to Linda about how she rescues those.
No worries, we'll transfer
okay. them. Okay. I thought site-wide went over out to the whole network as opposed to those of us who were just on the day's call. So
that's okay. We'll incorporate it. No worries.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
I just transferred it over, Ted. Thanks so much.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Great. Wonderful. Any other ahas, takeaways, any announcements? Anything you'd like the network to know about?
I'll just say, for me, hearing Jen's story, I think just that recognition, and it also relates to equity these days, but, you know, that learning that, you know, the humility to realize that our view of the system is only one piece of it, and likewise, you know, being a white person with some privilege, my view of how the system works might be completely different than a person of color or, you know, a different class. So I think that part of the convening and the thinking about systems, you know, the humility to realize we have to work together to understand and work within the complexity, I think is a really important part of the network process, you know, in the convening. And that's where the NCDD group has such skills for those phases of a network. I think that can be so valuable. Yeah.
Thanks, Beth. Yeah, that was my main aha. Similar, this movement from me to we, of course, climate change is a horrible problem, which is why I'm here, because I, you know, I see that this is one of the most important problems that we're facing as a human species. But I got from your talk today that maybe this is exactly what we need, as you said, for the next evolutionary leap. It really forces us together because we have to see the bigger picture. This is such a wicked problem. So we no longer can like exist in our little siloed entities anymore. Anybody else?
Well, I'm just, I spoke already, but I just want to say this quick thing. I'm just curious about how there can be more communications about the networks that currently exist. Like, for instance, I'm in Massachusetts, and the only network that I knew about was the Sustainability Directors one, and that was a happenstance because a person who works in our local 350 Mass node is actually on staff in a support capacity for that network, right? So, and that's not a local one, that's a national one. But I'm just curious, like, how can we get the word out more that these networks exist and about the work that they're doing?
Yeah, ultimately, we all have to be one big network. I mean, we should all be sharing what's working in climate change, but how do you do that? So the people who are on the telephone, Jan and David, is there anything you'd like to share?
This is David in Tampa. I'm just very excited at the fact that we seem to be very flexible and willing to learn. And we're very good listeners. And I really admire all of us on the conference for supporting the concept that we can learn from other theories of change, other ways that people respond. So thank you so very much.
Thank you, David. Daryl, if no one else has an aha, I'd just like to announce that the hosting team is going to be taking 2 months off this summer. We're doing our own retreat work. And so we will be back in September with, we hope, hopefully just a brand new way of doing our network. And thank you, Beth, for being so inspirational. I feel like you've really given us a lot to think about and to take into our retreat work. So I wish you wonderful summers, and we will be putting this recording up on the network. And I'll be working with the woman, I think she dropped off, Susan Davis. I know she'd like to share some things about what she's been doing, so we'll work with her to get that all up. And please reach out to us if you're interested in participating in NCDD with us.
All right, thank you, Linda.
Thank
you. This is Ted, I'm signing off.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, very lovely.
Yes,
very
thanks good. A lot, Beth. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Take care.